Gentlemen, if you want to look your best with high-quality clothing, then I recommend Main Street Clothiers and Custom Tailors in downtown Newcastle. Mike Caggiano is the owner, and he and his staff have been in the business for decades, and they will always give you the right recommendations. They also carry Rondinelli tuxedos. That's Main Street Clothiers and Custom Tailors, 210 East Washington Street, downtown Newcastle. Call 724-652-3851. Dineo and Olson Law Group, where every client matters. Serving Newcastle, Elwood City, and Youngstown. Dineo and Olson handles criminal law, bankruptcy, civil matters, workers' compensation, personal injury, medical malpractice, divorce, wills, real estate, and many more legal issues. Call any one of their offices in Newcastle, Elwood City, or Youngstown with these phone numbers. Open Monday through Friday, 9 to 5. Dineo and Olson Law Group, where every client matters.
Hi, welcome to the Washington Outsider on NCTV 45. This is host Matthew Geiger from the Washington Outsider. Visit us at www.washingtonoutsider.org for the latest news of the day. Today, we've been talking a lot about, on the show and on the blog of the Washington Outsider, about, you know, ways we can improve government, not only between governments, but how we can make our, you know, own government really function for people better. Last time we talked about, we kind of used Pennsylvania's budget crisis as a really good example of how our government's kind of failed at doing a lot of things. We've seen a lot in the news where, you know, national security, for example, we've seen a lot of shootings, and that's very, you know, problematic. We've seen a lack of economic development issues that have really just really hit the, you know, kind of the basic fundamentals of what government's supposed to do. And so kind of building on that, I want to talk a little bit about something what I'm calling principles versus practicality. You know, America's always been a country where we've kind of been more practical. You know, we've had principles, but we've always taken the practical route. You know, if you go back to the history of England, England used to do things, you know, this is the way we do it, this is the tradition, that's how we do it. The structure, you never deviate from the formalities. Well, we've kind of, in some respects, gotten a little stuck in principle. And at the same time, we haven't followed through on principles. We hear this on the right oftentimes that we need principles, we need this, this, this. And if they're always blaming the left for this, but you know, the truth is the right gets off on its principles. We just saw Donald Trump talk about banning Muslims from the United States. The practical course, if you could do it, may actually be banning Muslims, but that said, you really can't do it because we have so many people, and I've been kind of in a back and forth about why that's not only an impractical solution, but it's one that'll cause more problems. And so when we look at all these situations where we're not able to come up with a solution, what we need is we need kind of to come together and compromise, but our country's gotten so far back away from the idea of actually compromising that it's considered a bad thing, and I honestly don't know that people know how to do it anymore. I mean, and that's people in the government. What happens when we have two people who have very different thinking? How do you come together and compromise? And I think we've not only strayed from that, but our country's also kind of diversified a little bit more. The more we deal with the world, the more diversified we come. And so this really, when you talk about compromise, you're talking about coming up with a solution that works. What you're not talking about is just compromising for the sake of the compromise, which is, I think, another part of the reason why we've deviated from really being able to compromise, to be able to thinking that compromise is a bad thing. You know, we go against principle instead of for practicality, or we violate what's practical just to stick to our principles. We end up coming up with no solutions. We have no answers because we're so stuck on what we want to do or the idea that we come into. And so when it comes down to it, you have to understand what these fundamental things mean. What does principles mean? What does practice mean? And what, you know, what does compromise mean? And so to start this conversation, the first thing you have to do is understand the government is there to serve people. It's there to balance everyone's interests. We've talked about this either through this show, whether directly or indirectly. We've also talked about it on the a lot of the articles posted on the Washington Outsider. You can read them up any time, even on older events. You can see kind of this these themes woven in. But when it comes down to it, government, to do that, the people in government have to remember one fundamental thing. They're not elected officials. They're not here by voters. You know, they're here to be public servants. That's what they, and what does that mean? That's a question I don't think a lot of them come. When they go on the campaign trail, for example, they come up, they say a lot of campaign problems, little promises. When there's a lot of campaign promises, they come into office and say, well, people voted for me for this. You know, when it comes down to it, people vote for a lot of reasons, and you can't exactly tell it's which particular statement you've made, very rarely. And so when we spoke about this last time, that you can't just vote, you can't just come into government with your ideas and expect to get your way because you got voted in. And when it comes down to it, that means you have to compromise. And that means actually coming up with solutions that work for both sides. You know, the truth is that the campaign trail, what you make on there is kind of your ideas, what you'd like to bring to government. It's your thinking. But when you get into office, it's not just your thinking that matters. It's how you enact that. And that's the difficulty. That's where the compromise part comes. You can, you know, a lot of politicians make promises on the campaign trail that they have no business making. A lot of government policy officials make it now, and they get stuck in a political corner and where they end up violating their own principles. And that's partly because we see what is said on the campaign trail as a promise. And it's also their own fault for, you know, seeking election, doing, saying whatever it takes. But, you know, we have to have this understanding that, one, what's said, what people are voted into office is what they'd like. What they do in office needs to be in line with that, needs to be how they're fighting. Their objective, long-term goals is not to violate themselves. The second thing we need to understand is a public, that they are a public servant. Public servant means you serve the public, not just your voters, not just the people who can vote for you, not just the people in your community. It means everyone. And the higher up in government you are, the more people you're responsible for. You know, I've said this numerous times, U.S. senators and congressmen, they don't just represent their constituents. They represent their, they bring their voice there, what their views are. But their job is to serve everyone in the country. Just as everyone, the state legislators, senators, congressmen, they're all there to serve everyone in a state. Now, what this means is if we can understand this, if we can agree on this one, then this puts us to the point where what we need to understand is compromise. And when we come back, we're going to talk a little bit more about compromise.
Tuscany Square Restaurant, 3470 Wilmington Road, where old world charm meets today's modern conveniences. You'll enjoy their spacious, comfortable seating, their fresh ingredients that go into making every dish, whether it's pizza or that just right entree. Tuscany Square Restaurant, they're here to serve you. Call 724-654-3065.
InfoCision has been giving job seekers career opportunities for the past 30 years. 150 positions are needed to be filled as soon as possible, and many of them at the Newcastle location. InfoCision handles inbound and outbound customer service and sales calls for the nation's largest nonprofit and leading media and cell phone providers. Come join the InfoCision team that offers excellent benefits. You can call or stop in at 253 East Washington Street, Newcastle. InfoCision, the number one call center company in the world.
Come dine with us, come dine today. If you could use some real good food, there's a place not far away. If you could use a drink or two, or a place to go and play, come to Gallo's Italian Villa today.
The Crane Room is a restaurant. The Crane Room is a bar. The Crane Room is a banquet facility. The restaurant will please you time after time with their diverse menu. Ask about their daily specials. See the menu at craneroom.com. The bar gives you an abundance of choices with 35 beers on tap and always changing. Their banquet services are always to perfection. The Crane Room, located at 3009 Wilmington Road in Neshannock Township. Call 724-656-1553.
Hi, welcome back to The Washington Outsider on NCTV 45. This is host Matthew Geiger from The Washington Outsider, www.washingtonoutsider.org, for our latest take on the news of the day. And today we're kind of bringing together some of our conversations we've been having, talking about principles versus practical and compromise when it comes to making government work. And, you know, people... There's reasons people see compromise as a bad thing. One, you violate your principles, and others, you violate your you don't do anything practical. You just stick to the principles. You let the government shut down because you don't want to raise taxes. You don't provide for security because you don't want to offend someone. And that's the kind of stuff that really, truly, you know, makes compromise sound like a bad thing. You know, and I'm gonna switch up some things we've discussed before on this. And, you know, I think you have to understand why we have principles. And everyone has principles. For some, it's more religious than others. For non-religious people, it might just be your everyday life. Everyone has their own set of principles. And, you know, as a democracy, we have a set of principles. And, you know, sometimes you look at your principles and say, man, I really don't want to follow these things. And you don't, and it can cause problems. And, you know, our society's kind of, in the last 100 years, really, you know, we've become more academic. Some would say we've discussed this before, where people think in terms of intellectual. We break down information and see what's the cost-benefit analysis. We're more capitalistic in our thinking. And that's taken us away from, you know, the past where you would say, well, our religion taught us this. And, you know, that's not just a message for, you know, conservatives, that it resonates well with conservatives, but for liberals too, who have their own set of principles. And, you know, the things, the culture, the history we were raised with, you know, kind of matters less now as to what we can reason, how we can reason whether or not a behavior is. But the reason to put really the idea of principles into kind of terms that we can understand as a modern capitalist rational society, if you'd call it, is that it's not just, you know, just adhering to old-fashioned things or the way people always did it. You know, it really does serve a purpose. There's things that we can't perceive, that we don't understand, or that we haven't fully calculated. Accountants, businessmen, we call them unrealized costs. Unrealized costs, you know, they're broader than we can see. You know, you think of a stone getting thrown into a pond, a ripple effect. You also see in time, we make one action today, and it makes 100 problems worse later on. And that's where principles come in. When we have really good principles, they address those what they would call, again, unrealized costs of our public policies, of our decisions. They keep us from making these long-term, broader decisions, the consequences from the bad decisions we might make today. They protect us from our own selves. And so even though principles might not be convenient at the time, they're actually a very practical thing. And that's kind of the issue, I think, with compromise. People have really gotten to this notion that there's a principle versus practical. For the practical person, the principles might not have value. For the principled person, you're so rigidly adhering to the principle that you're saying no to the practical implications of there. And so when you talk about, the problem is that you can't just be a principled person or a practical person. You have to be both. And the right compromise, the right option, is to be both, to do the practical thing that is in line with your principles. And that's something I think, to do that, you have to understand why you're, what is the, could go wrong that maybe you don't understand, why you stick to a principle, why you have a principle. You know, and so in that respect, you have to actually understand why the principle exists. And at the same time, you have to understand when principle is causing problems. So that's where compromise really shines. You know, you're looking, let's go back to Pennsylvania, where we've had budget issues. Now, go to taxes. Not very moral, ethical concern here. Although, you know, there's issues. We have the notion of regressive versus progressive taxes, and that means, regressive means that we tax the poor at equal or more rates than the wealthy. That tends to make it harder for them to become less poor and exacerbates the harm. It actually causes harm to them. And in that sense, it is a moral issue. But at the same time, the progressive is, of course, the issue of taxing the rich. And for some, the principle is that you tax the rich, it's like a punishment. Well, I think we've said this here and I've written about it. You know, it's not about punishment. Maybe it has a disincentive from an economic perspective that on certain margins and transactions you might not earn as much, try to earn as much. But, you know, really, in a nice, you know, proper tax code, you're not going to have that issue. But, you know, you look at this, say, for instance, you look at sales tax. Now, no one likes paying taxes. And sales tax, a lot of people on the left have really said, well, this is very regressive. Even the people on the right who don't want to see it go up. And, you know, in some ways, this isn't just about, a lot of people get stuck on the principle that this is hurting poor people. Well, there's a very practical harm to it, too. And that is that what an income tax is a transactional tax. And what that means is that every time you make a transaction, well, if there's a higher cost to making a transaction, you're going to make fewer of those. So that can really have a really detrimental problem to the overall economy. And we see this in Pennsylvania, where we've had this back and forth over the sales tax. So there is a real practical. Now, at the same time, though, if we broaden out to the whole nation, we look at Wall Street and the very erratic nature of the stock market, where a lot of risk has been taking. You know, there was a few years ago, some talk about imposing a transactional tax on just a very small, just a tiny one, not even a percent, of how stocks are transferred on large scales. You know, in that respect, limiting the number of transactions may have actually been beneficial because it would have discouraged damaging, risky behavior that caused our overall system a problem. And so it's not necessarily just the principle, I'm against raising taxes, I'm against raising transactional taxes. It's about what is the practice and do you have a principle? I don't want to cause damage by raising a tax. That's a principle. The practical solution, when's it cause damage and when is it helpful to the economy? Now, and again, you know, and I have to mention this too, you know, you can look at, say you go back to Pennsylvania, and a tax that really irritates me. It's called the per capita tax in the Commonwealth of Pennsylvania. And you get taxed, it's only $20, but it's a year. It's $20 a year, everyone's supposed to get it. But the way in which they apply the tax is that the local offices can't necessarily identify everyone who's taxed. Everyone who's supposed to be 18 or older is taxed, but they don't have all the information, and when people move out and around, they miss people, they tax people they shouldn't, and it creates local offices that really have very little value, that, you know, it just costs. And it's a very regressive tax because it targets people who, you know, again, necessarily shouldn't be taxed. So, you know, people are against it in practice, but they're also against it for principle. Or they're against it for principle, but there's also very practical why it's not a good tax. It's just really a cumbersome, kind of wasteful tax to kind of make poor people pay the fair share, which is a terrible, terrible way of looking at it. You know, it's not practical at all. It is an entirely principle tax. Well, we have to hear from some of our local sponsors, and when we get back, we're going to kind of wrap up our conversation and maybe talk about, you know, some of the issues that have gone on today.
It's time to go to Chalela and Carney, floral design artists. For flowers, plants, figurines, and so much more. Whether you're celebrating that special day, that special engagement, anniversary, birthday, you name it, Chalela and Carney has what you need. At 1006 South Mill Street, it's Chalela and Carney.
Whether it's a scheduled appointment or same-day service, DiCaprio Carpet Cleaning offers 24/7 service for commercial, industrial, and residential, as well as fire and water damage restoration. Using state-of-the-art technology, DiCaprio Carpet Cleaning experts are ready to professionally clean your carpet today. Call DiCaprio Carpet Cleaning for a free in-home estimate. Thank you for making us Lawrence and Mercer County's largest carpet cleaner.
And remember, nobody gets your carpet cleaner.
Joshua Sun Rehabilitation Center. From the moment you arrive, you know that you're in the right place. Dr. John Wrightson listens first. He pays attention to detail. And then makes the determination. Joshua Sun Rehabilitation. We make the pain go away.
Hello, folks. Angelo Parada for Ferrone Brothers. Wow, you have to try their food. Great Italian food and two locations on the south side on Mill Street and on Wilmington Road in Newcastle. Ferrone Brothers for pepperoni rolls, pizza, any Italian dish that you can imagine. Okay, and a whole lot more. It's Ferrone Brothers. Stop by. They have those daily specials, and they look forward to seeing you. Tell them NCTV 45 sent you.
Hi, welcome back to the Washington Outsider on NCTV 45. This is host Matthew Geiger from the Washington Outsider. Come visit us at www.washingtonoutsider.org for our latest take on the news of the day and all the events going on. Today we're talking about how kind of ways we can make government work better. And one of the first ways you need to do is understand compromise, understand what it means. And oftentimes that comes down between people who have principles, who are standing on principles, at least claiming they have principles, and then people who are claiming to be practical. Now, being unprincipled creates a problem because you tend to ignore the long-term and the broader, you know, costs, the consequences of things we do and say today. And principles help us address those things without even thinking about it. We stay on our principles. But at the same time, you got to look around you, see your environment, see what's going on. The world doesn't stand still. You have to be practical. And a long time ago, our country just kind of did this. But we've gotten out of practice, and the world's kind of gotten smaller. We deal with a lot more people than we used to. They're very different. People, maybe not as different as we think, but their cultures, how we look, how we appear, how we sound, things we do, you know, we have a lot in common, but, you know, it makes it harder when everyone's coming from a different perspective. And so you really can't be either. You have to come up with practical solutions, practical policies, make practical decisions, and also kind of adhere to these principles to keep yourself from making not bigger problems from in the either now or the future for other people. You know, these things all have ripple effects. And so when we talk about, you know, really having practice versus principles, you know, it's about balancing and coming with the balance. And so when you make a compromise, you don't just, you know, I want this thing, I want that thing, let's come in something in the middle and make something we both don't want. You have to actually, it has to be a principled or a practical solution built on a principle, on principles. What is the principle? What is the shared principle we have? What is the common interest here? You know, this is repeated often. We see it in the tax code. We see it in the whether it's protecting people from harm done to the country, whether it's, you know, just the government deciding to do something. You know, is this the role of government? And you know, we're a democracy, so if people say it is, then it is. Does it violate the principles of the Constitution, the limitations, the structure that was put into government? And that's what principles are about, is structures. That's why we have democratic principles. That's why government has limits, we have rights, for that very reason. Now, we can look at a really big example that I don't feel is really being talked about a lot. You know, I see it doesn't make it in the news very often, but, and people, I don't know if they want to pay them, but the Trans-Pacific Partnership, TPP, you know, a supersized version of NAFTA, which here in Newcastle, Pennsylvania, in all of Western Pennsylvania, really wasn't well received. And, you know, I've talked about why that is, but if you look at it, it's this one-size-fits-all model, which really, when it comes down to the complexity of economies and of various industries you're looking into, because you're not even just talking about, you know, we tend to see things as political barriers, geography of countries, but in reality, you know, these industries aren't just about this country to this country. It's really about how the whole, these industries interact with not only within each other, but also within other industries. So there's this whole, that's the nature of our global economy. And by treating every industry, every economy in the same way, we create problems. Now, when you look at TPP, you don't have to read the whole thing. You have a situation where, you know, it's very long, but you start understanding very clearly that what they've done is they've kind of taken NAFTA and said, well, we want some safeguards so the unions can have power, so that policies can be made, so that richer countries can actually collect taxes without driving business out of the country. And they've just kind of thrown them in there, saying, well, this is the way. When you do stuff like that, you end up taking a flawed system, the problem, and making it worse. Because then instead of fixing the problem, counteracting it just makes, it just distorts, creates the distortion effect of the economy. And that's where you get into a situation where you've kind of made this bad compromise, this compromise that's not really practical, really doesn't fit anyone's principles, and it just doesn't work. And so when you come up with these, you know, when you come to the bar, you have to say, hey, what's our broad principle? What is practical here? And that's what it really takes. When is this practical? What is the impact of this? And you have to be willing to say to people, hey, you know, it's not just, you know, people will stand on principles, but, you know, we have a difference between shared principles and what we're saying as a principle. How does this apply in our real world? And that's, you know, that's really an issue we face with in our daily life as well. You know, people, you know, this is Christmas time, the holidays. You know, whether you're Jewish or Muslim, you know, and everyone else with principles, you know, you just start thinking about the kind of, when you're living your life, the principles versus practices you make. Well, that's a decision you make. The same thing's true for government. And so when you really talk about how do you run your principles, apply your principles, make them practical, that's when it really comes, that's when you're able to come up with these compromises that actually work, that are actually good, that make things work better. Well, this has been the Washington Outsider on NCTV 45. Just a few thoughts to have over. Please join me again on www.washingtonoutsider.org for our latest blog posts and whatnot. And don't forget to tune in to NCTV 45 for a lot of great local programming here out of Newcastle.
If you're having a party, then Keystone Specialty is the place you need to go. Yes, they have every party supply that you can imagine. Planning that wedding, that graduation, or maybe it's just that big game that's coming up, go to Keystone Specialty. Party supplies and so much more. Remember, they have those fall decorations, winter, spring, and summer. It's Keystone Specialty on the south side of Newcastle, Mill Street.
Butts Flowers and Gifts offers top quality flower arrangements and gifts for any occasion. The pros at Butts Flowers and Gifts provide exceptional customer service, and each bouquet is hand arranged. Stop in and check out their wide selection of gift baskets and plants. They provide flower delivery service locally to Newcastle, Bessemer, Edinburgh, New Wilmington, West Pittsburgh, and across the nation. It's Butts Flowers at 120 East Washington Street in downtown Newcastle. Call 724-652-7727 or toll free 1-800-443-7726. The Cedars is a great restaurant with outstanding Mediterranean food. The Cedars takeout menu is second to none, featuring pizza, stromboli, hoagies, their famous lamb on the rod, and so much more. So when you're hungry and you want that Newcastle taste, make it Cedars. Now with two locations in Newcastle, 827 Addis Street on the east side and 1101 Highland Avenue. Call Cedars East, 724-658-9260, or Cedars North, 724-652-7657.
Hello, friends. Are you a person on the go? Do you need snacks, cookies, maybe just a deli sandwich, lottery, or gas? It's Geno's in Mahoningtown for all your needs. Stop by Geno's and tell them NCTV 45 sent you.